Good morning, everybody, here today, and welcome to 1 Million Cups. I'm your host, Trezzy. So first off, I want to say a quick thanks to our sponsors, Dream Bank, for the space and Starting Block, for their continued support of 1 Million Cups. Today we have an awesome presentation from GLW Technologies. Nick up here has some really cool stuff going on that I'm pretty excited about. But first, we're going to go around the room and do some introductions. And you're all regulars. I don't know why I need to say this. I'm Trezzy. I'm the MC.
My name is Josh Helling. I'm one of the co-organizers. I'm also a co-founder of Rootstock Partners, where we work with non-technical founders and executives to get software product strategy right.
I'm Jay Martin from Martin Product Design. I'm so pleased to be part of this gender diverse crowd.
We were not to emphasize that today.
You know, I noticed that. What's going on here?
It's weird.
And you've done that in the past.
Every time.
Hi, I'm Keith Fuller, and I have a service in town called All About EX, where we help startups handle all things people.
I'm Brian Sampson, Tempor consulting and lead software guy.
I'm DP Knutton, marketing branding guy. I help people discover their true stories and communicate them via the most efficient channels possible.
John Coffey, Springfield Welding and Max Hayes Products.
I'm James with Calls on Call, a shared receptionist service for small business.
I'm Derek. I'm the guy that does the video. I'm a media technologist.
I'm Dan. I'm an accounting guy.
Everybody's a guy.
Very casual today.
I'm Mark. I work for Fredmont.
I'm Nick. I'm with GLW Technologies, and I am a 3D printing guy.
Chuck Sarah, intellectual property attorney at DeWitt.
Peter Cabby, I'm a financial guy with Bank of America. We focus on peace of mind surrounding certain financial security.
All right, well, one more time, thank you all for joining us. DP just reminded me, thank you, DP. I got all out of order at the beginning.
It's okay.
I did that at the top, though.
Check.
Make sure to grab the 1 Million Cups app and check in. I'm going to turn it over to Nick for a presentation. Let's hear it for Nick and GLW Technologies.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming here today and coming to listen to my presentation. It's always great to have a nice full room. I apologize. I am not quite the morning person. I've taken a lot of caffeine, so if you see some jitteriness, I am not having a nervous breakdown. It's just a lot of caffeine. So, but why I'm here today is I want to talk about 3D printing for your small business. And who are you and what makes you qualified to talk? It's a question I constantly ask myself. I own GLW Tech. We're a 3D printing firm in Madison, Wisconsin. We're technically in the Glarus, but all of our clients here in Madison. I've been working with 3D printers all the way back to the original little cupcake box that used to break every print, up to industrial size machines that can print like entire blank frames in one shot. I've printed so many different parts, I can't really count. My main job at GLW Technologies is to take any given part and analyze it for what it is, how it'll print best, work with hundreds of different settings, analyze materials, and then set it up for a manufacturing-based run so that we can stream it to all of our printers and just have something that's production quality. I've done super simple stuff, I've seen super complex, I've done many, many different materials. I don't know if I would claim myself an expert because there's not many people who are experts in new technology, but I think I'm good enough till the next one comes along. So I never like to have a lot of runaround when I talk with clients, so I won't run you around now. Is 3D printing right for my business? Yes. If you were already thinking of it, this is just give you the same answer. If you guys need to leave right now, that cuts it short. But the next is going to be how and why. So, 3D print. Originally, I was at Ford Fest, and we covered this really cool topic called disruptive technology. And I went on to Investopedia. Is that anything that Pedia seems to be legit. And I went in and I got this really great definition, and it was disruptive technology significantly alters the way businesses or entire industries operate. It often forces companies to change the way they approach their businesses for fear of losing market share or becoming irrelevant. Disruption is processed by a small company with limited resources, such as a startup, successfully challenges a larger, established, incumbent business. Companies often don't have the flexibility to act quickly to new threats. So it's really an important thing because it allows anyone who's a small business to start going toe-to-toe with someone who's making $800 million a year. And there's this really great movie in the 80s called Other People's Money, and it was one of my favorite actors, Danny DeVito, about a short bald man who takes over the world. I think you can understand why. Basically, it's the best quote I could say. It's a little harsh, but I think he really gets the message across. So I'm going to try to play that.
Where I come from, you always say amen after you hear a prayer. Because that's what you just heard. A prayer. Where I come from, that particular prayer is called the prayer for the dead. You just heard the prayer for the dead, my fellow stockholders, and you didn't say amen. This company is dead. I didn't kill it. Don't blame me. It was dead when I got here. It's too late for prayers. For even if the prayers were answered, and a miracle occurred, and the yen did this, and the dollar did that, and the infrastructure did the other thing, we would still be dead. You know why? Fiber optics. New technologies. Obsolescence. We're dead, all right. We're just not broke. And do you know the surest way to go broke? Keep getting an increasing share of a shrinking market. Down the tubes. Slow but sure. You know, at one time there must have been dozens of companies making buggy whips. And I'll bet the last company around was the one that made the best goddamn buggy whip you ever saw. Now how would you have liked to be a stockholder in that company? You invested in a business, and this business is dead. Let's have the intelligence, let's have the decency to sign the death certificate, collect the insurance, and invest in something with a future.
Long story short, I do recommend that you guys do check this out. It's a great, great discussion item where he's trying to explain why they should sell their shares in a cable company. And it's very interesting because he goes into depth and into disruptive technology, and usually you don't see something that's mainstream really hit upon this. So why is this important? Because 3D printing is, by definition, a disruptive technology. We're in the middle of a fourth industrial revolution. We should all be excited. We are forever going to be changing the way we make things, and it's never going back. What really started as Chewbacca tokens has now flurried out of control, and now this is really cool. That's a 3D printed rocket engine that's going to lower space costs by 1/10. These are 3D printed shoes. Imagine going in, getting a scan of your foot, and having a shoe that's never awkwardly too small or too large, but exactly printed to your needs. As these companies 3D print, and they're going faster and easier, they're challenging established markets, and then they have to move to compete with them, and that means demand is going to be greater than supply and is only expected to skyrocket. And in as much the same way where we saw a boom with everyone needing an IT person to get their network set up, you're going to see everyone needing someone who's got some additive manufacturing experience if you're working in that firm. But we're still very nervous. No one sure is how the market's going to come down with this new technology. So I also like to do a small case study here. Time is limited, but basically, when we talk about the carriage industry, there were 4,600 companies in 1914. And then 10 years later, they had 150. And 5 years after that, there were fewer than 90. And that's really what happens when a disruptive technology enters a market. Entire established industries are going to just suddenly be destroyed. But the it's not all bad. Some of these carriage companies actually went on to become automobile manufacturers. And so by embracing a technology early in your development, you can kind of brace yourself for what is going to be the inevitable change. So what the heck is 3D printing? Probably most people have a glimpse of what they think it is. I'm focusing on what's called FDM. I'm not going to get too big into the technical specifics of all this, but I guess I wanted to just kind of give people a brief view of what it is and what it can do. So this is a press up. And you can see this is a famous chapel. Also, if you want to attract more customers, but you can see highly complex, highly detailed, and printed layer by layer.
What's the real time?
I'm assuming this is something like 24 hours, something like this. But this is definitely overkill for most of what we do in 3D printing. But this, you've got even some nice overhangs. There's your infill. This is a high detail print.
So is it printed from the top?
It's printed from the bottom down, and then there's.
Going up from the bottom, just like that machine looked like it was on top.
Yeah, right now they're taking a picture every time it resets for the layer. So, otherwise you would see the mechanical side of that. So we can do stuff that's on a detail level. You would never be able to injection mold that. That would be an impossibility, and that's really where we talk about the changing evolution of that technology. So how does it all apply to my business? This is really important. And this is what we call design for additive manufacturing. This is what my business does. Basically, we take your idea and we view this through a new lens, and that's called design for additive manufacturing. Old school parts were you'd have 10 different parts, you'd create a sub-assembly, and that assembly would have been 12, not the final product. New paradigm is that we would design one part to perform separate functionality and print it all as one unit. And so that cuts down on assembly, it makes it a stronger product, you're getting less labor, less materials, and oftentimes higher quality. So what we can do is we can make these really complex multifunctional parts within a single print. And that's really changing the way we're 3D printing. And then, by the way of saving money, we just saved a client $11,000 last week because they were going to print theirs through injection molding. We came into it and now they have $11,000 to spend on their business just by doing this process. But I can only get things in plastic. Man, that's always the question that we get. That's not true. If you can imagine it, we can print it. So this is someone that we partner with, Virtual Foundry here in Stoughton. And this is a full line of metal filaments. They're gonna be huge for the future of 3D printing. We have ceramic filament, conductive filament, we can actually 3D print minor circuitry right into our prints. Wood filament, flexibles, which are going to be really cool. Not to mention, we talk about the shoes thing, this is kind of the simpler examples. 3D printed tires, imagine having a tubeless tire that never goes flat, it just wears down, and they'll just 3D print you a new one at the shop. Carbon fibers, this is our big earner right here. Carbon fiber materials are changing. They're lighter than any other plastics. They're stronger than any other plastics. And typically they're really hard to work with, except if you use them for 3D printing. And so we have actually built a drone for the UW-Madison system at 1/10 the current cost, but it's able to free lift 25 pounds. It makes it one of the strongest and most powerful drones in the market. And also because we use additive manufacturing, one of the cheapest. So we're planning on destroying the industry with that. Of course, and yes, plastics too. Of course, you have your PLAs, your PETGs. This is a Tallman line of industrial nylons. Here's the big one. PEEK used to be very, very difficult to work with, but now we're 3D printing PEEK. So let's say you broke your hip and it has to be replaced. You would go in, they would scan your hip, 3D print a replacement part in PEEK. It would be perfectly scaled to your dimensions. You would never have joint pain for the rest of your life. That's printed in polycarbonate. Yes, plastic can be strong too. It's really gonna have a really disruptive force on our industry. And of course, there's many more applications that I can't tell you about. Every day I look around and I find someone doing something new with 3D printing. This one is probably gonna be the coolest. We're hoping to get into this ourselves. What they're doing is they're taking stem cells and they're injecting it into a fluid with a chemical catalyst, and they're telling this to be a liver and this to be a heart. And yes, they've 3D printed fully functioning organs. And so you're gonna go in the hospital and say, I need a heart transplant. They're gonna take an injection of pluripotent stem cells and they're gonna 3D print you one in the back room and then give it to you. And you'll never have rejection because
You'll be out by noon. So.
Yeah, well, hopefully, but heart transplant as an outpatient procedure would be a really kind of beautiful thing. And a new liver that never hit my 20s would be kind of a nice thing too. But that's gonna change our medicine and prolong all of our lives by a dramatic amount. And of course, the fun one, 3D printing chocolate. Like I said, you can imagine someone's probably thinking about it and or probably doing it. So we kind of doing that. So, but this is really like abstract. How can we do it? So four preferred methods are creating molds for non-3D printed products, creating housings, casings, and other structural parts for short run products, developing one-off products to increase productivity, i.e. custom tool or manufacturing device, and large volume personalized marketing items. So a lot of people are asking, what is short run? What does that really mean? Short run is not what you think it is. It's actually, if you're making less than 10,000 units within about a year or two's time, you really should be additively manufacturing. Because that's when you get your biggest price break on return. Anything more than that, you really should be going with the traditional manufacturer, but less than this, you're always gonna come out on the positive side by just going with additive manufacturing. And for most people, that encompasses almost all small businesses and most medium-sized businesses. So something to really think about. Especially like tool manufacturing production. This is something that we engage less so, but still very important. You know, we always are working, there's that old paradigm, you work with the tools you have, not the ones you want. In 3D manufacturing, we say, work with the tools you want. So maybe you need something specialized to just do something that you need to get done. So we can do that for you. Another thing people don't think about is, what if I can't get the tool I need when I need it as quickly as I need it? A lot of times when you're working with very remote spaces, sometimes it'd be hard. And this is actually the most remote space. where they're actually adding manufacturing tools on as they need them on the space station. But here's another thing. There's a hurricane ravaging most of the southern United States. There are companies who have added manufacturing machines. They take them to these problem areas and they're reprinting the infrastructure of these areas using that tool. So it can be really interesting. Mold and principles. This is pretty much, we're shifting away from this because as we accommodate more materials, we can just print directly, but still many different ways of forming resins, rubbers, clays, food products, metals, waxes, the list goes on. So even if you're not something that can be directly 3D printing, you're probably printing adjacent, which is cool through this mold. Business guy, show me the money. I know our accountants will probably be very interested in this part. Well, you'd be saving 9 out of every 10 production dollars if you went to 3D printing. What if you had to spend $100, but instead I said you only need to spend 10? What do you do with that $90? Almost anything you want. Spend it on your marketing. Show that your company is more viable. Spend it on employees, training, who knows? The sky's the limit. Like I said, we're saving clients money right now here in Madison, and it's revolutionizing their businesses. Okay, here's the great question. So, there is a variety and quality of printers every day, and it lowers your cost every day. So that's the next question we always get from our clients. Great, I'll just go out and buy me a few printers and we'll do the same thing you do. Less so. So their new technology, as I often joked, one of our most unreliable printers is our Epson printer that we use to do our documents. These are kind of really complex mechanical machines that require 2 to 4 hours per week to maintain. Unless you've got the technical expertise to do that, I would be hesitant to buy machines for my company. Try a local makerspace first, or use a prototyping firm like us to really kind of get yourself basically comfortable with the technology. And of course, as we discussed earlier, does traditional manufacturing have a place? It does. And that price break, as you can see, is about this 10,000 unit run. So there's some really complexities to that chart, but just for the simplicity of it, that's where it breaks down. So,
okay. All right, let's hear it from GLW.
What is the right size job for your business? Are you trying to be the Kinko's where I only have to do one of these every 3 years, so I hire you guys, or is it a, I'd love to use you as a rapid prototyping arm of my company? Is it a combination of both?
It's a combination of both. So we have, basically when a client approaches us, they usually don't have the required processes in place to really tackle an additive manufacturing run. So we usually what we do is we onboard them, we redesign their product, and then we just give them those STL files, and they can go with anyone they want to. But we do say to them, look, all we have to do, we use the same printers on our R&D side as we do on the manufacturing side. So if you want to, and you want to go right into your production run, we'll just stream them to all our printers, and you could be producing 100 or 1,000 units, you know, starting next week. And so it really streamlines these processes for these companies who, instead of spending years to get a product on the market, they could be spending months. That saves them time and money.
The multiple materials you had, including wood,
yeah,
which is crazy.
Yeah.
Are these different machines for each material?
It's a complicated question. Right now, they're, I don't think anyone's made a quote-unquote super machine yet, but we're getting to that point where it's like a replicator in Star Trek. You're just going to 3D print you a meal and then also, you know, a pair of shoes. But right now, we are using some specialized machines. Right now, we use 5 independent machines to do different things. We have a Sigma for detailed prints. We use carbon fiber for our carbon fiber, our flexibles, and then we have a different machine for artisanal printing that does it in color. So, and then we have another one coming online in a couple months for our full metals line with virtual foundry. So, yeah, it's, you do need some selectivity.
So you're working in conjunction with other companies, a metal forming company?
Yeah.
I know their clients, so I know a lot of good people.
Yeah.
How do you work with them? Does someone come to you and say, I'd like this made out of metal, and you contract with Virtual Foundry, or buy their product and do it, or how's that work?
We buy their product.
Good question here, just for the on the audience. The question is, how do you all partner with these metal forming companies like Virtual Foundry?
Right.
Yeah. We buy their filament, and it's still pretty early stages, but they have a lot of really cool filaments that they work with already, and we're working on integrating those with our printers so that they're specialized to work with the metal, the Virtual Foundry's metals. More than that, they have other things that they're working on, and they're certainly I can't talk about it, but. I'm very excited to see what they're doing with the market, and they're going to be, I think, going to be having a huge impact on the future of our industry. So
the bottom line is they're the print toner manufacturer.
Exactly.
You're the printers, and you're a beta test site for some of their materials?
There's been discussion of that, yeah. So a lot of it is getting material is half the battle. Then we have to get into the printer. We have to figure out how it can orientate the best. What are the settings? What makes it comes out clean? So it's something that we can present to a client and feel, yeah, this is something that this is a production grade component, and that's something we specialize in.
Yeah, what's your biggest challenge right now as a company?
Biggest challenge right now? That's a tough question. Right now, I think it's informing our industry. That's a lot of what we do here today is informing small businesses. A lot of people know what 3D printing is, but I don't think they fully know what it's capable of doing and how the technology has progressed to the point that it can help their business. And so getting out, informing people, making them aware, showing them that, yes, this could be production done for you, I think is our biggest, single biggest thing. I've actually had a client think, he's like, oh my God, you can do that? You're gonna save me thousands. I gotta tell people, and that's what we want to hear when we go to these meetings. So that I think that is our biggest challenge right now.
Yeah. What is the moat around your business that
protects you. And by that I mean, you know, if your business is highly dependent on, I can tell you what your business is, my impression is highly dependent on the technology available to you. You gotta buy a machine, and you basically develop an expertise around these machines and materials and lend that expertise to manufacturers. And so kind of you're in a sense a middleman. You're not developing the technology, you buy the technology, you learn about the technology, and then you apply that technology to somebody that doesn't want to kind of develop the expertise that you have. But as history has this sneaky way of squeezing out middle people, right? And I'm wondering what the moat is around your business model that sustains your value in that production sequence. Does that make sense?
Yeah, the question here is, as a middleman in the industry, what's the moat, the protection around your company against competitors?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. And actually, I didn't really get too much into our business model, but we're not as much as a middleman as we actually build and design our own printers. All the printers that we own were made by us, with the exception of the Sigma. We produce those and maintain them and upgrade them in-house. Which actually we're mostly vertically integrated at this point, so we're doing it cheaper, faster, better than anyone else. As materials become more specialized, more and more, there will always be generalized firms that could probably cover a PLA or an ABS. Dozens here in Madison, but are you going to be able to do a carbon fiber? Can you do a high energy peak? Probably not, and so that's why we also specialize in individualized filaments for specific companies. So that's kind of our trade favorite. Well, that's a good question. Yeah.
I can see where an appeal to this might be for a company like ours, a law firm or an accounting firm, or with more intermediates, and we want to add a tchotchkes, little things that are unique to us, unique to our business, that actually has our name and printed on it. I guess the question, though, the impression I got from you is that 10,000 units is sort of the break point for creating or producing these things.
Uh-huh.
What if we only wanted 500 or 1,000? Is it still worth it for us to come to you and say, can you make this little statue?
That's actually an excellent question.
So the question is, for production runs of 500 to 1,000, like less than that 10,000 product breakpoint that you listed, what's the proposition? Should people be looking at it if they're doing under 10,000 products?
I will learn to stop and wait. That is an excellent question. It's something we encounter all the time. And yes, in fact, can order much smaller units. Like I said, we are a rapid prototyping firm. We do orders as low as one and as high as 999, whatever. So, and the cool part about 3D printing is once we have your, what's called your G code, so your manufacturing code for these set up, we can print, five of yours, 10 of his, and 15 of his, and all on the same machine and all on the same day with no switchover. So that's one of the great flexibilities. You know, whether we're doing, guided missiles or baby bottles, machines don't really care. It's all about the materials we use in the G-code. So it really gives us a huge amount of flexibility.
Jay. So Nick, I love your presentation. I love your energy about this. I have a lot of experience with this as part of a design firm. And we have a number of real critical issues with 3D printing.
Sure.
Okay, so, we think it's great for helping vision what might actually, what you're thinking of. But for things like, there's an issue with, for example, the isotropic nature of the materials that come out of FDM, and you know this well. And we've had a whole bunch of trouble with that. And so, do you see any sort of solution for that?
So the question here that Jay is asking is, what sort of solutions are you all looking into in terms of the issues that major manufacturing groups are looking at with 3D printing right now, such as the isotropic nature of the prints?
If I get your meaning of that correctly, I think I do. It's an issue. There is some problems with how FDM bonds within layer to layer. I'm assuming you're talking about like Z-axis.
Yeah, okay.
It's something that we encounter, and that requires a combination of different things. Basically, it's going to come down to how you print the part, how the part comes together, the materials of the part, and then is there secondary post-processing to strengthen certain fatigues and weaknesses along that Z-axis. I know that Midwest Prototyping has communicated the same thing, that they have those same issues. Way we do it with the design for additive manufacturing, we try to minimize stresses in that area and focus on materials that are capable of handling something like that. It's kind of a complicated process, you know, it's not something that I can probably tackle.
Anyway, I can talk more with you about.
Yeah, please. But it is something that we do tackle on basically a daily basis.
So we've got time for two more questions. So, DP?
Just in thinking about your place in the market, you've got, I'm just going to use an analogy, you've got Kinko's or FedEx Office to do Xerox copies, you've got high-end 4, 5, 7, 8 ink printers doing Taushan art books. Are you closer to the Taushan art book artisanal premium layer, or are you, where on that continuum do you guys fit?
That's a really good question. That's a really good question. I told you I would learn. I'm not quite there yet, but I'm coming. Right now, I don't know if we're quite in the artisanal spot. Like I said, we build our own printers. Our goal was to have 10 by the end of the year, and we're at 5 now. We will have 10 working industrial printers by the end of the year if this things continue to go. If we get our spot in Glarus, which we're looking to do with a couple of big contracts we have coming down the line, we will be going as much as 30 to 40 printers. So you have to remember each of our industrial grade printers is capable of about somewhere between 100 very large objects and 10,000 very small objects. So with just the 10, we could probably do something like 100,000 parts, just right now. About a month, so per month. Basically, we're still finding the Madison market and our place in the industry. I think the demand is going to predicate how big we go. I think we're still a new company, so we're still feeling that out to answer questions.
And we will pass our last question off to James. Sorry.
I was in the 2D printer world, looking to get into the 3D printer world.
Sure.
And the 3D printer world scared me because the CAD designs that were needed.
Yes.
Right, so from a manufacturing point, is the expense in the CAD design or is the expense in the actual printing?
It's both.
Expensive.
It can be really expensive. Like I said, if we wanted to have 5 printers just normally of an industrial grade quality, it would probably going to cost us somewhere around $250 to $500,000. Some of these ones one example of a metal printer, like the one we're building, costs $400,000 in of itself. It's an expensive field to get into. The CAD design, that's something that you really kind of have to know. But there is a beautiful website called Thingiverse, and you can find literally anything on there. I'm sure most of you by smiles in the room have. that could be a real time saver if you don't know CAD design.
So from a consumer standpoint, can you touch on that? If a customer comes to you with, I want his coffee booth.
Yeah.
And you have to put it together in some language that the printer understands.
Yeah.
Is that more expensive than actually printing it?
It depends on the product and the materials used. It's kind of something that we would have to go through an assessment for. Typically, things like coffee cups, which are, unless they're customized to meet a specific demand, it's probably better to just buy them online.
from like Vistaprint or whatever. But if you need something very specific, then we might be a better solution for you. So.
All right, well, let's hear it for GLW. Thank you for coming. Are you going to be hanging out a little bit after? I am going to be hanging out for a little bit because I know there's a lingering question there. So any follow-up questions, anybody that wants to catch up with Nick and get cards, feel free to pop on to it afterwards. One more thank you to our sponsors, Dream Bank for the space and Starting Block for their continued support. Don't forget to grab 1 million cups. I loved having you guys here to like remind me of everything. Grab the 1 million cups app. Make sure to check in. I think that's it for today. So one more time for GLW.